The honest answer is there's another shirt that looks just like this, that's not crypto, and we just copied it. It's an anti-social social club.
But interesting story.
That's the one that this lady who visited our booth in Bitcoin 2021, in consensus last year, probably belongs to you. She came in and she asked, like, what is the anti-fiat crypto club? And we're like, oh, well, you know, so we just all get together and we want to promote crypto, and, you know, and you know, the dollar's kind of going down in value as it has been the past 100 years. And she's like, that's interesting. Do you guys, when do you guys meet? How many, who's in it? I'm like, would you like to meet? You're welcome to join. She goes, oh, no, I work for the White House. Like, you're still welcome to join. You know? She kind of didn't get it, as most government officials didn't get the joke, right? After like 5 minutes of kind of joking with her, I finally said, lady, it's a joke. Right? Like, there is no club. It's a t-shirt. It's literally just a shirt. She's like, oh, okay. And she kind of walked away. Maybe it was our fault, the White House and Biden administration is kind of like where they are now. It all started with an anti-fiat crypto club. And some lady coming by our booth. Yep, our fault. Yeah. Yep. Oh, is it live now?
Are we good?
D or E?
I have no idea. Oh, here we go. D?
Yep.
Okay. All right, here we go. Thanks everybody for coming by to the June Bob meetup. How many people here are new to the event? Just raise your hands. Oh wow, cool. We got some. You're not new. You've been here before. Would you raise your hand? Okay, cool. Thanks for coming by. For all of you that are new to this event, or at least any of the meetups that we host here at this location, my name is Paul. I'm CEO and co-founder of Edge. This is our office and our home, so welcome. Treat it nicely, but definitely enjoy and come on back. We've got quite a few events that happen here. The one that you're here at today is Bitcoin Open Blockchain, hosted roughly once a month with great guest speakers such as ones that you're going to hear from today. There are other meetup groups. ETHSD has hosted some events here, CryptoSD, and sometimes Chainlink. We do host or post those events on our website, edge.app/events. And for those of you that might be unfamiliar with Edge, we're a self-custody app that lets you buy, sell, and trade crypto while still holding your keys and with a very high level of privacy. We try not to collect any personal information. Actually, we don't. As a company, we don't know the personal information of any of our users. We strive to continue to keep it that way and connect people to a lot of decentralized solutions such as DEXs and DeFi. So definitely invite you to try the app, give it a shot, and please send us feedback because we don't know what you like or don't like about the app because we just don't track it. One of the biggest challenges of being a private app is knowing what your users do or don't do or what they stumble on. And with that, I want to introduce you to one of the other organizers of the meetup, Chris Groshong from Coinstructive. You can kind of maybe give us a quick update on some of the legislation and you know, his travels
through the
space.
Real fun stuff.
All the fun stuff. Yeah. And kind of continue on with the rest.
That's
of
why I didn't have me start up here because you guys would have started throwing stuff.
Cool. Thanks, guys.
Legislative updates. Boo! So luckily, I don't have a whole lot of legislative updates because I just haven't had many. So there are a couple things that I will mention. South Dakota, I don't know if I mentioned this last time, but South Dakota and North Dakota passed laws earlier this year that include virtual currency business license components. So those two states have been added. Illinois did have a bill that was recently being pushed, and it didn't make it out of legislation. So the Illinois bit license failed. So good job, Illinois. You got something right. California is still working on their bills, and they're all still pretty much up for debate. So they've passed through appropriations, and at least the big ones. And so we're still waiting on a crypto licensing bill and a kiosk bill. And we'll see how that goes. I'll keep you updated at the next one. Was there a question? Here, we're not usually taking questions in the beginning, but we got.
So my question is, these bit licenses, is that what you referred to them as? Are they designed to resolve regulatory uncertainty for the businesses and shield them from like arbitrary regulatory attacks?
Thanks for the question, Seth. That's a great question. No, it doesn't. At least not to the degree of the federal level. So the states are making determinations on what activity needs to be licensed. So for instance, if you're doing payment processing, right, typically you have a carve out and there's an exception. But when you're doing crypto payment processing, you're going from crypto and you're swapping it into dollars, and then you're taking those dollars and putting it into somebody's account, and that exchange into dollars they consider an exchange. And so it's not exempt, and you would need a license because you're handling the money and converting it and doing all this stuff. So at the state level, you would have to get a certain amount of license, but it doesn't preclude you from like what is a security and what's not a security. It's kind of like the states have passed marijuana laws, but federally, right, still not cool. So same kind of situation. There is no federal harmonization of it, and the states are kind of doing their own things. And that's why they're coming out with DAO laws that give some corporate structure. Some of them are talking about how they can be used for so they can pay their taxes without having full corporate structures. And there's things that are coming out that the DAO bill, at least in California, didn't make it. So people are still trying to wrap their head around just what blockchain and crypto is. They didn't know what a DAO was at all. So nobody could even vote on it. They thought they were going for Asian food. Everyone was all for it at first, and then they were like, this is too complicated. I don't understand this menu. So anyways, it's still very much, what's the word I'm looking for? Abstract, I guess, in a lot of ways at the state level for some folks on certain aspects. And it doesn't give any real regulatory clarity from like an SEC purview, like we're talking about, right? Because Coinbase and Binance are in the news right now because of the SEC. We've all seen that. So even there's state regulators that also do securities, and there hasn't been any clarity there either from the state regulators. So it's very much a gray area for a lot of folks. And if there's only the only thing you can do is do it at the state level, then that's what people are going to do. Unless you get a bank charter, right? And even then, the banks now, because of the way that things have happened to the other banks are not interested in getting into crypto right now. So that's my update. Okay. And all right, so tonight we have two really great guests. First off, anybody travel from outside of San Diego here tonight? We got one. Oh, that's only it. Oh, this is great. It was hyper local event tonight. North County, yeah, kind of. It does. For you tonight, it counts, sir. All right. So we have two guests tonight. I'm going to talk about our second guest first. He'll go on second, and then our speaker, who's making my job a lot easier because her information is already on the board behind me. Our first speaker, his name is Michael Tutberidze, and he's from Georgia. There he is. He's standing in the back. He's going to be presenting tonight on. Oh, I wrote down the topic because it's complex. But it's really good. It's asymmetric cryptography and RSA algorithms. So this is kind of like the fundamentals of like why Bitcoin is secure in the first place. So we're gonna get kind of a close inside look. And the great thing about it is that Michael has a PhD in computational mathematics, and I didn't even know that was a thing. So I was like, yeah, exactly. I thought computers did all the computations. So we got a genius here with us tonight, and we're really looking forward to having him present to us. So, and next, our speaker, who I'm really pleased to have with us tonight, and she's visiting us from Puerto Rico currently, right? That's where she resides. She's a local, sort of, not for tax purposes anymore. So Medha Parlikar is the CTO and co-founder of Casper Labs and the Casper Protocol, and she, in and of herself, is a very smart and talented woman, and I got to sit down with her earlier today and get to know her a little bit more, and she's got a fascinating story. So ask questions at the end, right? She's a huge resource, and she's got some really great things to explain to us tonight about Casper Labs. So please welcome to the stage Medha Parlikar. I see I spoke too long.
My computer thinks so. Yeah, so thanks, Chris, for that introduction. So I'm really happy to be back here in San Diego. I spoke at this meetup. It was at a different location. I think it was 4 years ago. It was ages ago. And that was when I think Bitcoin was trading maybe at $3,000. It was a long, long time ago. I think it was like 2019, 2018, before the pandemic. That 2.5 years kind of just flew off of our calendars and our radar. So very happy to be here. Medha Parlikar, CTO and co-founder, and we founded Casper Labs, my partners and I co-founded Casper Labs in 2018, October, Halloween, Casper the Friendly Ghost. We founded the company in Wyoming on October 31st, 2018, with the express purpose to build an enterprise-grade or enterprise-friendly blockchain protocol. And so we set out to build a protocol that I would use. I come from software engineering industry. I worked at mp3.com. Everybody knows mp3.com, the most spectacular failure in San Diego. 175 engineers strong, amazing technology. We had mp4.com, which was YouTube back in 1999. And we managed to screw it up with a copyright infringement lawsuit. Way to go. didn't listen to the lawyers back then. Really should have listened to the lawyers. So. There's a lot of MP3ers still local here. And then I went to go work at Website Story, which is another iconic San Diego company. They were acquired by Omniture, who was ultimately acquired by Adobe for $1.8 billion in 2009. And in these companies, I was their global head of quality control, quality assurance. So I was responsible for engineering and delivery, getting products out to production and making sure they stayed up. And then I went on to work at Avalara. Avalara was a Seattle-based company, but they had a small company here in San Diego that they acquired called Taxient. And Taxient had a lot of inroads with Intuit. They did tax compliance. And so I worked with Taxient, and then ultimately Taxient was folded into Avalara proper, and then Avalara was most recently sold to Vista Equity Partners for $8 billion. And so I was one of their go-to engineering directors. I ran a lot of their operations and engineering across their compliance suite. And so when we set out to build a blockchain protocol, I built one that I would use, that I would deploy in my production systems, that I could build products around, that I could upgrade, that I could integrate, that I could rapidly iterate and deliver against. And if you look at a lot of the blockchain protocols in the space now, when you actually try to work with them, it's very challenging. And you know, the Ethereum ecosystem has done a tremendous job of building layers upon layers and layers of infrastructure, and they call it ecosystem, but infrastructure to make it easier to develop on these blockchain protocols, right? But we feel that a lot of that should just, you don't need all that extra overhead. You should just be able to work with the protocol directly, right, in a seamless way. So Casper Labs is a company that was founded expressly to work with enterprises, right? And so, you know, this is one of the decks that I share at a lot of the talks that I do for industry, and so we're going to debunk a popular myth that I don't think needs debunking here, and that is crypto and blockchain are not the same thing, right? And so a lot of my presentation today is really going to be talking about what is the perception of crypto in industry when you go and talk to Fortune 500s and Fortune 1000 companies? What are they thinking outside of our crypto bubble about this technology? And we're finding that a lot of global executives believe it's the same thing, right? And that we have spent a lot of time and energy separating the technology from the application of the technology, which is crypto, right? And crypto is really challenging right now. Businesses really don't want to adopt it because all they think about is FTX, Luna, and the regulatory challenges surrounding cryptocurrency. And so what Casper Labs has really had to do is say, okay, we're not a crypto company, right? You don't have to worry about SEC coming after you if you're working with us or if you deploy blockchain because there's no crypto involved. And it's an additional challenge because we also provide software updates for the public Casper network. And that's what Casper Labs' contribution is to the Casper protocol. We contribute software updates. We listen to enterprises, we listen to businesses, and we implement those requests that they have for the core protocol into the software, and then we propose those upgrades to the community in hopes that they will accept it. So juxtaposing crypto having all of these regulatory challenges with the blockchain, the underlying technology itself, there's a massive opportunity, right? And we always had the thesis that enterprises were really going to be leading the way for mass adoption. If you talk in crypto circles, everybody's talking about the mass adoption of blockchain technology. How are we going to get mass adoption? How is everybody going to have a MetaMask wallet? I actually think that people ultimately are not going to have MetaMask wallets. There's mass adoption of this notion of all of this complexity that is like in the user's face is not going to fly, right? Like, I think about mass adoption is when my mother feels like she can use email, and it's hard for my mother to use email, you know, like just email, right? But you think about, I think about my husband using a crypto wallet. That can happen. He's never gonna. I love you, honey. He's never going to use a crypto wallet. He's like, you just take care of it, babe. I can't deal with any of that. I don't know what that stuff is, right? And so, abstracting all of that away and really trying to uplift the benefits of blockchain, which is sovereign identity, sovereign reputation systems, provenance, trust. These are things that we believe you can expose the value to the consumer, right? Even if you're just using the underlying technology. And there's ways to secure that technology so you don't worry about, oh my God, it's a private blockchain. There's no security associated with blockchain. There's ways to work around that, right? So we are working to shield or enable businesses to use the technology without the regulatory fears they're dealing with the SEC and this whole crypto thing. And so, you know, there's two big sets of language here, right? So you're seeing this is the way enterprises are really thinking about this. They do believe in tokenization, right? So we're working with, I'll talk about it later, a company that is tokenizing patents. Really, really interesting stuff. And very much being received well by businesses. Versus you thinking about, you know, DeFi and yield farming and trading, like a lot of this stuff is really loaded. They're loaded terms in the space. Web3 is a loaded term with businesses in the space right now. And we have to be very careful if we want folks to work with blockchain technology. So this is the adoption curve of internet users, you know, and you're thinking about the total crypto users. I think this number is going to go way higher than that. But it's following a very similar adoption curve. And so we can extrapolate the adoption curve for the internet, the adoption curve for cloud, and the adoption curve for blockchain are going to be very, very similar. Enterprises are going to lead the way, number one. Number two, it's going to take time, right? It's going to take at least another decade or so to really see ubiquitous adoption. I believe Moore's Law is going to have a role to play. What does that mean? That means your node-to-node communication has to go way up right now, right? So that physical infrastructure, when you talk about passing messages over a decentralized peer-to-peer network, there's a lot of optimization still to be had there. That's the number one blocker in all of these proof-of-stake networks, is how quickly can messages traverse the network. The second thing that you're going to need is more silicon, so you get more throughput and computation from the nodes themselves, from the actual silicon, right? And so I feel like there's a lot of research and emphasis being placed on consensus protocols in this space, but really we need the physical infrastructure to go someplace, right? We need that physical infrastructure to be optical cable, right? And that's going to take decades, right, before we can start seeing the kind of throughput that everybody wants, the kind of throughput that everybody needs in order for it to be ubiquitous, right? We were doing wireless content delivery at mp3.com in 1999, but there was no 5G. Guess what? You can't deliver content wirelessly without high-speed bandwidth, right? It was the high-speed bandwidth that made the technology accessible. The technology was there. You know, the technology to stream video and content was there in 1999. We built it. We built it in San Diego. Nobody could use it because there was no Wi-Fi. There was no high-speed networking. There was no high-speed, you know, cable even at home. So, okay, so I could download a song in, you know, 15 seconds from MP3 servers. Doesn't mean that somebody could do it at home over dial-up, right? So that's what really needs to happen to transform the performance of these networks. So let's talk a little bit about use cases, because, you know, oftentimes you feel like you hear that, oh, blockchain's a, you know, a hammer looking for a nail, right? It's very expensive infrastructure. It's expensive computation. But we are seeing a lot of use cases around, you know, single sign-on self-sovereign IDs. We're seeing a lot of use cases around supply chain, particularly cold transport. So you think about, you know, like the COVID vaccines had to be transported at a specific temperature. And so there's a big interest in, you know, using IoT sensors to actually track the efficacy of the shipping containers, like the, you know, that the product within the container is not exceeding a certain threshold of temperature while it's in transport. And then you, what do you get from that? From a healthcare perspective, you get better efficacy for patients. You know you're not administering a spoiled product to patients, right? So even if you do the cold chain transport, you still don't have a guarantee that during transport, the entire time it didn't exceed a certain inner core temperature, right? And so this is something where you can get guarantees, not just of provenance, which is the source of the good, but really how it was transported en route, right? And the Casper protocol has some very unique capabilities within it that make supply chain an interesting use case for us. And then, of course, finance, tokenization, clearance, settlements, and know your customer, or KYC, right? There's a lot of KYC systems out there that are running on blockchains, both, you know, Hyperledger blockchains as well as Casper blockchains. And so really three, you know, super interesting classes of use cases. What do you say that they're use cases, right? And so, yeah, like businesses, you know, constantly face this creativity push, right? They're always having to adjust to what's coming forward. It could be governmental regulation. It could be new features. It's competitive advantage. It could be the intersection of all three. And so what you're looking for in a protocol, I believe, you know, a lot of these public protocols have this notion of, like, immutability. So what does immutability mean? Immutability means that once I put something in the blockchain, it can never be changed. And I think that's absolutely perfect when you're talking about Bitcoin transactions. Bitcoin, I put a transaction on the blockchain, it should never be reverted. Alice sends Bob one Bitcoin, that's it. It's Bob's Bitcoin, it never gets reverted. But what happens with a smart contract? How many of you have written an application and you got it right the very first time you wrote it? Never had to change it again. Ever. Like, there were no bugs, it worked exactly the way you wanted it, you never had to change it after that. Yeah, answer is absolutely zero. Like, never happens, right? And so on Ethereum and a lot of the other protocols, all the EVM chains especially, they have to use a proxy model, which basically says, well, behind door number one is a contract. Today it's contract version number one, but oh, I decided to upgrade it, so now behind door number one there's a different contract, it's version number two. But you know, observing that when you're doing things like composing contracts and you're using the Ethereum blockchain to create this building block, right, or this, you know, you're using different contracts on the Ethereum blockchain through something called composability, just like we compose software out of libraries. You can use small contracts on Ethereum like libraries and you can call multiple contracts, but you have no visibility into if that contract has been changed. If the methods signatures and the APIs for that contract haven't changed, you have no way of knowing if it actually is the same contract. because the protocol doesn't do anything to tell you that the contract is different, right? Because you're calling the proxy. You're not calling the contract directly. So what you see is the proxy. The proxy routes your message to the contract. The contract could have changed. And so this is a problem that I feel that the protocol needs to solve for and provide transparency and clarity and the same mechanics that we're used to as engineers today, which is if I'm going to import a version of a library, I know the version of the library. It has semantic versioning. And if I want to use version 1.0, I use version 1.0. If there's a new version, I can choose when I want to use version 1.1. As a software developer, I should be entitled to do that. I should be able to say which version of the library I want to include in my application. And that's something that Casper does natively. It enforces a protocol version and a contract version on the chain. So you don't get to cheat. And this is one of the core capabilities of Casper. So our value proposition, we have the core Casper technology, a technology that's built for businesses from the ground up, using WebAssembly and a lot of features with a very complex permissioning scheme, in addition to the features that I just described, like upgradable smart contracts. And then Casper Labs is like the Red Hat for Linux. We're here to help customers use blockchain. What are the use cases you're looking to adopt? Do you need help with smart contracts? We nurture the Casper ecosystem. We provide support to ecosystemic projects. That's our role in the Casper protocol. We're also finding that businesses love hybrid blockchains. And remember I talked about having a private blockchain that has the security of a public one? So you probably see this in Ethereum as well, that there's a lot of what we call layer twos. Polygon does this. Polygon is a public layer two for Ethereum. Polygon doesn't really have a very strong consensus protocol. It gets its security from Ethereum. And it does this by, you know, something I like to refer to as checkpointing. And so we can checkpoint Casper blockchains as well. You can run a private instance that is completely wholly controlled, but we recommend that you run a hybrid instance so that your private blockchain can be provably immutable. And you can provably make it immutable by just phoning home. You just phone Casper, and you send your block hashes to Casper, and Casper's like, yep, those are block hashes are immutable. And then you can connect your block hash in your local network to the block hash on Casper and say, yep, my blockchain is immutable. I haven't done anything to tamper with this blockchain, even though I control the participant set. And this is a really powerful feature, and you know, we are learning from our partners at IBM and our partners at Hyperledger Foundation that a lot of enterprises are looking at hybrid. And you know, the funny thing is, this is what they did with cloud. So anybody who remembers VMware in the early days, it was all about VMware on-prem. Like everybody was using, oh yeah, we got our data centers, and we're gonna run VMware in our data centers. And the guys in network operations were really afraid about losing their jobs to the guys at AWS, and nobody wanted to go to the public clouds. Nobody wanted to go to AWS cloud at the time, because it's like it's all about preserving that capability of running your own machines in your data center. But then they started doing something really interesting. They were running VMware locally, but then they realized that when they had a capacity overflow, they had to go to public cloud. They had to overflow to a public cloud, and that was the first thing they did, is they started using Kubernetes, they started using AWS. Like, okay, we can start log shipping to AWS. And they started having these hybrid implementations where for some of their less critical stuff that they didn't worry about, we'll send that to AWS. And then pretty soon there was a full bore migration for all of their core systems to AWS because they realized it was cheaper, it scaled better, it provided better guarantees. We suspect that the adoption curve is going to be very similar here. That with newer technologies to provide privacy that you need, or the ability to provide multi-party computation that allows you to shard information that goes in the blockchain, or homomorphic encryption. We're going to hear from a cryptographer later today that there's going to be ways to leverage the security and guarantees of public infrastructure, even for private companies and financial institutions. But it's going to take time. And we're finding that this is playing out in the market, right? We did a survey of a lot of executives, and they are much, much more interested in a hybrid system where they have some control and they can get the guarantees of a public network without having to go all in on a public network. So we're going to talk about a hybrid deployment. IPWE is a hybrid deployment with Hyperledger Fabric and Casper. And IPWE is tokenizing 25 million patents on the Casper protocol. And so if you think about the problem around intellectual property is that there is very little provenance. Once the USPTO issues a patent, okay, at that point in time, for that instant, you know that that is the patent owner. But if the patent owner sells, leases or otherwise distributes their patent, the provenance and the tracking of all that information is next to impossible. It's literally up to you as the patent holder to keep track of that, nor is your patent discoverable. So nobody knows who they can contact to see who the owner of the patent is. You can't get a valuation for your patents. There's no marketplace where you can connect with people that want to buy your patents. And so IPWE actually built a system that uses AI, has created a marketplace, and has a repository of 25 million patents that they're going to now tokenize and make available with licensing, buy and sell, and valuation. Right? So this is a great example of where you're using the blockchain to secure the intellectual property, which is a very high value asset. You can buy, sell, and trade. And then within their system, on the you buy, sell, and trade using Hyperledger, and then you securitize the actual underlying asset on a public blockchain like Casper, because it is very high value. So you can also use hybrid public privates for liquidity exchanges. So we're seeing atomic swaps, and we're seeing bridges across public and private networks to get you know, those kinds of liquidity that you're looking for, right? So I see a future where banks may be using Hyperledger for their tokenized assets, but then they're bridging those assets over to stable coins and Casper, right? So imagine if a bank wants to get liquidity and they're actually using a blockchain to track their assets, you actually wouldn't see the problems you saw with Silicon Valley Bank. Like, those wouldn't have happened. The reason they happen is because they don't have real-time visibility into their balance sheets. And so using smart contracts and using a blockchain, you can actually get that real-time visibility into your balance sheet so that you don't have a liquidity crisis like they did. You know, the quintessential run on the banks. And that's it. We talked a little bit about use cases. We talked about hybrid. We talked about the tech. So I can take some questions. If anybody wants to ask me anything, you can ask me anything.
Questions?
Yes.
Question. Oh, hello. Here we go. I went too far.
Hi. Thank you. Yeah, well done. So the first is the difference between Casper and Hyperledger. And is the Hyperledger fabric indeed? Do you know which one is it?
Hyperledger Fabric. I mean, Hyperledger's got a lot of products in its suite. Hyperledger Fabric is like the blockchain, right? So, you know, Hyperledger Indy is identity. Hyperledger Fabric is the base blockchain layer. Hyperledger Cacti is the integration, the system that actually integrates other protocols and systems into a Hyperledger ecosystem. So Hyperledger Fabric is a blockchain. There's differences in the consensus layer, the way transactions are gossiped. There's also differences in the fact that Hyperledger is purely a private blockchain. So Hyperledger has no public deployment. There's no way to take a Hyperledger deployment and make it into a public deployment. You can't do that. It doesn't have a truly like hardened consensus protocol such that it can withstand the really harsh environment that a public network undergoes, if that makes sense. So when we talk about public networks, how many of you understand like you know the different flavors of public networks, right? So you've got open permissioned networks, which is Hedera. And what does that mean? It's like if you want to be a participant in Hedera, you have to join the Hedera Council. You got to be somebody to join Hedera. You have delegated proof of stake like EOS, where you're voted into the validator set. They have 21 validators in EOS. You're voted into that's delegated proof of stake. That is where the community votes you in to be a validator. And then you have open, permissionless public networks. That is Ethereum, Bitcoin, Casper, Near. I'm not going to say Solana, but the other ones, right? Where you have a group of participants. Anybody can come and go from the network. That is permissionless. If I can come and go from the network without asking anybody, that's permissionless, right? If it's decentralized, that means it's anywhere in the world, right? So it's not like me and my five friends. Anybody can join, right? And there's a capability for anybody to come and go. So that is not possible in Hyperledger. In Hyperledger, you wholly control the nodes. You wholly control the computers, the participants in the network. And it's more a distributed ledger than it is actually a blockchain protocol. It's not a blockchain protocol per se. It's a distributed ledger. And there are differences in the way transactions are sent, the way they're finalized. The mechanics of it, right? It's a lot easier to do things to a Hyperledger. It's a lot more like controllable. Like even with a Casper protocol, if you're running the Casper protocol in a private network, it is possible for you to do what we call an emergency upgrade to change the global state of the network, but it is not trivial. It's very difficult, right? It's challenging. It's an engineering effort. So Casper, the history is basically immutable. So that's what a big differentiator between Hyperledger and Casper. Yeah. It's a long-winded question answer. Yeah. I think that mic's, is it on? Okay.
So in that slide you had up with the differences between the cryptocurrency ecosystem or whatever and the enterprise one, a lot of the items, oh, thank you.
Yeah.
On the world blockchain side, only one of these seems to have to do with value, which is the tokenization. And in your experience with talking with customers, how much interest has been expressed in, I'll just say, the concept of moving value around, either within the enterprise or between enterprises or them and their customers? And if does Casper support that? And if not, do they provide facilities where they would have hooks into existing cryptocurrency blockchains to do that through the Casper ecosystem to abstract it away from the enterprise?
Yeah, so absolutely. Enterprises are very interested. Like, you know, we talk about tokenization. This isn't just ERC-type tokens, right? This is really, like, we're talking about NFTs as well, right? So the patent NFTs, right? And the patent NFTs are ascribed some value in fiat. You have to bear in mind, though, like, the ERC-20 tokenization model carries the bane of the SEC, so there's a lot of fear around that, right? But what you can do is, like, we have an atomic swap with Hyperledger that's very interesting for banks, to say, okay, I've got this asset that's a bond, it's an asset-backed security, I already know it's a security, I've registered with the SEC that it's a security, and now I want to express that security using a public blockchain. There is such a thing as a securitized token offering. There is a way to tokenize securities. They would just do it in that way. So absolutely, there is interest in that. They are just a little reticent with the public protocols because there's other things that happen with public protocols, right? The community dynamic is a wild card, right? The fact that it's a shared resource also makes it a bit of a wild card. Well, you know, Terra Luna happened on Ethereum, right? Terra Luna collapsed, but the whole thing happened. I think it happened. Maybe it happened on Terra blockchain. But there have been a lot of hacks on Ethereum. Not Ethereum's fault. These are protocols that are on-chain, but some of that tends to blow back on the base protocol. And so there is some concern in enterprises around using public blockchains for those reasons, if that makes sense. More questions? Yeah.
Could you please explain a little bit about, like, if you can, how legally binding is this use case about the patents, tokenizing patents? I'm just trying to understand, like, is it really backed, you know, by some, you know, document that describes that I have a patent? So, I mean,
yes.
It's still hard to imagine a situation where I go to a court and I show them some, like, NFT in the wallet, which is a patent. Like, how do you connect this, like, the technology level with the legal part? I understand that you're not dealing with legal yourself as a company, but
correct.
Since you have this experience with this particular use case, I'm just trying to understand it.
Yeah, so the source of the patent data is coming from Clarivate. And Clarivate is a very large company that this is what they do. So they already have recognized, they are recognized in industry as to be an authority on the provenance of patent data. So they have this patent data that streams in. The purchasing, the buying and selling of a patent between two parties that happens on Hyperledger, that contract negotiation goes through a traditional legal format. Like it happens, there's a traditional buy and sell agreement between the two parties when a patent goes from A to B, right? Now, what becomes, why is the blockchain interesting? Well, any adjudication around the patent, any legal findings around the patent, any legal history around the patent, that can all be recorded to the blockchain. So it's not just the patent itself. One of the things that Casper allows you to do is write mutable metadata to the blockchain.
Yeah.
So you can actually write this whole data structure, but the mutable metadata is in the patent NFT itself. So the NFTs are semi-immutable, right? So you can have the NFT, which is immutable, but then it has this blob of data attached to it, which is the history of everything that has happened to that patent since it was pushed onto the chain. So that's where the value comes in, and the contracts themselves are bound legally, and they would be adjudicated in court separately.
So it's like tokenizing the content of the contract.
Correct, yeah. I mean, the blockchain is really good about saying this happened at this time, and you can view the history of a thing.
My question would piggyback on his in that I'm a real estate broker, completely different field. But, you know, it seems like there's a lot of talk about NFTs and whatnot for contracts in real estate. No one I know is using anything like that. So I'm just wondering if it would be the same as a patent or if you know how Casper would be supporting that.
It actually...
You know, through title, yes.
It's actually a fantastic use case, and there are countries... like in Abu Dhabi and Dubai, where they are actually the registry of land. We actually met with the registry of land in Dubai. The registry of land is actually wanting to use Hyperledger. They're using Hyperledger. Hyperledger's got a great footprint in the space for that. They're using that to actually track land deed and title, right? Because there's a lot of title theft right here. A lot of title theft, yes. And so a blockchain is a perfect use case for that because nobody can steal the provenance because it's written, it's an immutable record on the chain, right? So yes, eventually NFTs should be used. It doesn't really matter what it is, but you will have this notion of this is a parcel number. It is an immutable record, and attached to it, there's a whole bunch of history with it, right? It makes sense. And you can secure that on a public protocol and make it immutable, so it's very, very tamper resistant.
Okay, so knowing that you guys are like basically publicly permissionless of blockchain, so in terms of like privacy, do you guys use maybe like zero knowledge for having data on chain, or how would you, you know? And also, that's kind of like one of the questions. The second one, maybe you can also answer. Possibly, it would be like, what is the specialty? Like, if we have data pushed on chain, and there's also that obvious security or privacy reasons, then is there like the speed and efficiency and so on, like all of that also related to the question, if you can address it.
So yes, I mean, Casper's Turing complete, right? So Casper's Turing complete, so you can support zero knowledge proofs on Casper. There's already a ZK implementation in Rust for the Casper protocol that anybody could use today. You can also do a multi-party computation where you shard it, right? You basically shard the information and you reassemble it off-chain. So you can also have Merkle proofs or proofs around sharded information. So homomorphic encryption is also something that you can do to shield certain pieces of information. You can also do something very simple as a hash. You can store the data in a separate instance elsewhere off-chain, and then you can store a hash on-chain to prove the provenance of the data. There's a lot of different things you can do. It really depends on what it is you're trying to do. Are you trying to do everything on-chain and you don't want to have any infrastructure running in the cloud or any Web2 instances because you want to put everything on-chain completely and be totally self-sovereign? Or are you saying, no, we need to hold some of our data, you know, privately, and we're fine to securitize that privately, but we want guarantees around it being tamper-proof, right? We care more about the provenance and copy protection.
And then, okay, so in terms of like actually having data on chain, let's just say not a lot, but a lot, like considerable amount. How about the speed and like in terms of transaction processing and so on?
Yeah, so the transaction, it's interesting with Casper. So the throughput per block is pretty respectable, but the block times are slow. So block times on Casper are 32 seconds right now. We're going to be reducing the block times to 16 seconds. Now this is for the public network. If you run a private permission network or a hybrid network, those block times can come down significantly because the validator set is compressed, right? You go from 100 validators and 200 plus participants down to 5, 7, or 11, and the block times can go up quite a bit because there's a lot of consensus overhead in our current consensus protocol. In our next release, we're going to be dramatically reducing the overhead associated with consensus down to it being linear. Right now, it's quadratic. So as the validator set increases, the consensus overhead goes way, way up. So, you know, future work. I think I'm probably out of time. So Chris is coming up to me. There's more questions, we can talk later.
Yeah, that. Thank you so much.
You're so welcome.
That was amazing. What a great
presentation. I hope everyone enjoyed it. Thank you. You guys are great.
Thank you, Medha. Well, you see why I like Medha so much. She's such a great speaker.
Thank you.
And she's got a really, she's really knowledgeable. So I'm really glad she was able to make it here tonight. And so while our next speaker sets up, Michael, who is now local, he's been here for a little over a year, year and a half or so, and has been a regular to our community. And so he came up to me about, I guess it was during the last meetup, and said, hey, I would like to present. I think I got something that the community would like to hear about. And when I looked at it, I was like, oh, yeah, this is great. So it's a little technical for even for me. But I still think that it's important that, one, we kind of give ourselves the opportunities to expand our knowledge, because a lot of times when I talk to developers or folks who have more knowledge technically than I do, I actually end up, if I ask the right questions, I end up learning magnitudes more than I would if I just kind of stood on the sidelines and kind of just took it for granted. So without further ado, here is Michael. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, thanks to Edge, which is hosting our presentation. Thanks to you for your interest in this presentation. Now we are going to start. I want to put to you one question. Why do we need encryption? We need encryption because when we are having conversation and somebody listens to us, we don't want them to know what are we speaking about. We cannot prevent somebody from listening to us, but we can protect our conversation, yes? Therefore, we need encryption. What is symmetric cryptography? What is symmetric encryption? Symmetric encryption is when we use some secret key for encryption and the same secret key for decryption. But to use the same secret key for encryption and decryption, we need to agree on that secret key. And how can we agree on this secret key? The best way to do this is to whisper in your ear this secret key. But if I whisper to your ear now secret key, we can tomorrow start conversation and encrypt our conversation with this secret key, and nobody will be able to decrypt it because nobody will know this secret key. But it is not always possible to whisper in your ear the secret key. And we need something different. Now assume that there is no internet. Imagine that there is no internet. We will remove this assumption later, but now imagine that there is no internet. So here are symmetric cryptography algorithms. For example, this. This is a very well-known algorithm. But in case of symmetric cryptography, we have only one secret key. In case of asymmetric cryptography, we have, together with the secret key, we have non-secret key also. The secret key is called private key, and the non-secret key is called public key. But what is asymmetry here? Asymmetry here is that private key must be non-computable from public key. So it means that public key may be computable from private key, but private key must not be computable from public key. Public key is known to everybody. What is public key and what is private key? I'm sorry. Oh, I wanted to show you something, but one moment. Why it is not? Okay, so this is locker. Everybody can lock this. Everybody. And it's possible for everybody. It's locked. But to open this, we need key. The only one key can open this locker. Yes? So this is public key. This is private key. Everybody can lock with public key, but only one key can unlock it, and this is private key. We will return to this later also. Now, okay, let's... public key can be known to anyone because it can be used only for encryption. But private key must be known to only one person who will decrypt the information. So everybody can encrypt, but only one person will be able to decrypt. Now, this is Bob. Bob wants all messages to be delivered to him securely. Bob says that I will listen to you only if it is delivered to me securely. I will listen to your message only if it is delivered to me securely. Bob chooses his private key and public key. Of course, they are corresponding to each other, but so he chooses private key, and basing on his private key, he can choose public key also. And Bob announces his private key, his public key, to radio, and says to everybody that if you, even TV, he can use it on TV. So he announces his public key on radio and says, if you want to connect to send me a message, please encrypt it with my public key. But private key remains known only to Bob. And Bob won't tell it to anybody. And Bob doesn't worry about that his private key will be known to anybody because, as we already said, private key cannot be calculated from public key. Sorry, private key cannot be calculated from public key. Therefore, this is Alice. Alice wants to send message to Bob, encrypted message. She learned about Bob's public key from radio. She uses Bob's public key to encrypt the message for Bob. This message is intended for Bob. She encrypts a message using Bob's public key, and she sends it to Bob, but she doesn't need to send it to Bob. She may announce this encrypted message on radio. She can do this. So she can broadcast this message, encrypted message, on radio. What is doing Bob? Bob heard Alice's encrypted message from radio. He wants to know what is this message, does this message contain, how he needs to remove encryption. He needs to decrypt this. Fortunately, Bob, and only Bob, has the private key, and he can decrypt this message using this private key. This is key. I'm sorry, it is not visible, but it is key. And this is local. This is Melanie. Melanie wants to know what was the content of Alice's message. He wants to know. What has Melanie? Melanie has Bob's public key. It was on radio, so he knows it. Melanie also knows Alice's message, encrypted message, which was encrypted by Bob's public key. It was also on radio. Can Melanie learn Alice's message? No. He cannot. But why? Because Alice's message is encrypted and it can be decrypted with private key only, which knows only Bob. First. Second, public key cannot be used for decryption. It can be used only for encryption. So if Melanie wants to send something to Bob, he can use this public key. But if Melanie wants to decrypt the message which was intended for Bob, he cannot do it using public key. Melanie cannot compute private key from public key because it was the main requirement for asymmetries. Private key must not be computable. It must be non-computable from public key. So Melanie cannot do anything, actually. There is another problem also, that errors, asymmetric algorithms are not efficient, so they require much resources. So if you want to send me a small text, okay, you can use asymmetric algorithm, but if you want to send me movie, for example, or something, some big information, it is very difficult to encrypt everything using asymmetric algorithm. So we need to combine asymmetric and symmetric algorithms. And how can we do this? Why cannot we use symmetric algorithm? Because we need to agree some secret key, which is impossible, which is not possible always, which is not possible always, which is possible only if I can whisper to your ear. But what can we do now? So Alice wants to send big information to Bob, but first she needs to agree some password with Bob, some secret key with Bob. So she writes, she generates some secret key, then she takes this secret key, encrypts it with Bob's public key. Sorry, I'll try to do, okay. And she sends this to Bob. I'm sorry. I'll do it again. Let me do it again for you. I'm sorry. Oh my God. Why it is not working? So I wanted to do it for you, but I'm afraid. Okay. Sorry, let's do it later. Sorry. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, it's working. Sorry. So once again, she generated some password, secret key for symmetric encryption. Now she's encrypting this using Bob's public key, and she's sending this to Bob. So Bob will get this. He will unlock this using his private key. He will read the password, the secret key offered by Alice, and then now they can switch to symmetric encryption and do everything symmetrically. Now let's recall that internet exists. I forgot this slide. I'm sorry. Now symmetric. They share, Alice and Bob share the same symmetric, secret key for symmetric algorithm. Now let's recall that we have internet, and the same problem is on the internet. We need to do something on the internet, something like that. How is it working? We have server. We have client. And we usually client wants to connect to server securely. Yes, client connects to server, gets the public key from server. Server is Bob. Client generates some random secret key for symmetric algorithm encryption, and then client encrypts it using the public key obtained from server, and send this to server. So only server is able to decrypt the information which was encrypted by client. After this moment, both server and client share the same secret key, and now they can switch to symmetric encryption. That's the idea of. So, of course, it is a very difficult system, but still, this is the idea of secure socket layer or HTTPS protocol, for example. Now, about errors, I will say several words about the RSA algorithm. RSA algorithm is the only algorithm for fully supporting the asymmetric cryptography. There is also another algorithm, Diffie-Hellman algorithm. I will have some opportunity to tell you about this later. But the fully supporting asymmetric cryptography algorithm is RSA. Authors are Rivest, Shimar, and Edelman. They invented this algorithm in 1977. They got patent on this algorithm in 1983. But now this algorithm is in public domain, so anybody can use it. So they don't need specific license for that. But there was a time when everybody needed some license because it was patent protected. It was protected by patent. What is asymmetry here? Why it is asymmetric? What is asymmetry is based on? It is mathematics, but it is school mathematics. It is not high school mathematics. It is school mathematics. I will tell you the number, 323. Can you tell me the two numbers, the multiplication of which is 323? You need to use brute force for this, because there is no way to find this. There is no algorithm to detect, to find these two numbers. Only brute force. But if I tell you two numbers, 17 and 19, you can easily calculate their multiplication. That's the asymmetry. That's the asymmetry here. So multiplication is easy, but to find these two numbers from their multiplication is almost impossible when we have so big numbers. Therefore, the idea of RSA crypto algorithm is the following. We need to find, suppose I'm Bob and I want to have private and public keys. I will have to find P and Q, which are very large prime numbers. Prime is the number which has only which can be divided only by two numbers, one in itself. So we need to find very big, very large prime numbers, P and Q. And they must be secret. Their multiplication will be public. I can broadcast it through radio. I can say about N through radio, the multiplication. Because I'm not afraid that somebody will be able to detect P and Q in real time, because he or she will need to use brute force. And it will take many and many years. So P and Q will are secret, and they help me to find. You can assume that you can consider P and Q as private key. You need some computations. But if you need to know more, here is the link, and I will ask the organizers to upload this link in our group. I there is some mathematics here, if you want. So P and Q are secret, and N is public. N can be known by everybody. So that's the asymmetry once again. One, to calculate N from P and Q is possible, but to calculate P and Q from N is not possible. If we have time, I would like to show you a small application which demonstrates how the RSA algorithm works, and I also uploaded code to GitHub. And I will also ask the organizers to print this GitHub address. Okay, so one moment, please. Okay, so okay. Oh yes. Do you see it? Do you see it? Okay. Now let's generate RSA key. You can go here and see that RSA key is generated. What I want to tell you is that, as I told you, there are several components. So this is this is public key, and this is also public key. So exponent and modulus are public. N is modulus. N is modulus. Exponent usually is taken equal to 65,537. Usually, exponent is equal to 65,537. As for modulus, modulus is n, which I already saw. This is multiplication of p and q. So exponent and modulus are public keys. D, P, D, Q, P, and Q, and inverse Q, they are private keys. So I will remove it from here and I will store it separately. I want to show you something, therefore I will store them separately. So we have now only public keys available. Only public keys available. Exponent and modulus. Now let's encrypt something. I need to run this application again. Let's choose second option. Second option. Let's choose some text. For example, thanks to Edge. Now it's encrypted. And here we have encrypted text. It is now. Let's try to decrypt it. I will run the application again. Now let's try to decrypt it without private key. It will cause error, but still, we got error here. K doesn't exist. So they said that K did. So what we need to do, we need to return here private key. And run it again. Now let's choose the third option. Your text was thanks to Edge. That's all. Thank you very much for your attention. Here is the link to GitHub. I will ask to upload this to our group's page, but where is font? Okay. 20 is enough, I think.
Yep, we can definitely get that uploaded onto the site. We can post it onto this meetup's comments. Okay. Does anyone have any questions for Michael? All right, yes. We got some from Hader.
So for asymmetric, can you speak to the selective disclosures using asymmetric? So selective disclosures. So when, as a signer, if I sign the entire message and send it to someone, can this someone only reveal certain part of the message, not the entire message? Do they have to reveal the entire message? Let's just say.
You cannot unhide the part of the message, the whole. But the size of the encrypted message is restricted by the size of modulus, size of n. So if n has size equal to 2048 bits, the maximum size of the information which can be encrypted is 2048 bits. Yeah. And the the same information will be decrypted, not the part of the information.
Over here.
A lot of people don't use RSA so much anymore for new projects, especially in crypto. But in crypto, we're not really encrypting with the public key. We're more signing with the private key and verifying. So are the more common public-private key algorithms such as like Schnorr, which is a form of ED25519, can that not encrypt with the public key? Like, is that only for signing? Because you mentioned RSA is the only algorithm that has full public and private key cryptography capabilities. So I was curious about that. Admittedly, I've never used Schnorr for encryption, but I wasn't sure if it can do that.
So digital signature is also based on, we have three digital signature algorithms. One of them is based on RSA, one of them. A second is DSA, and the third is ECDSA. In case of RSA, we can easily reconstruct our RSA in order to use it for signature signing. For example, what you need to do here is that if you want to sign using RSA algorithm, you must encrypt the message not by public key but with private key. So if you use for encrypting private key instead of public key, it will be signature.
Can you do that with Schnorr?
Sorry?
Can you do the reverse with Schnorr? Can you encrypt with a public key and decrypt with a private key?
Can Schnorr encrypt with a public key and decrypt with a private key?
I don't understand what is Schnorr.
Schnorr, ED25519.
Yes, so it is asymmetric, I believe, part of asymmetric
No, so ECDSA.
ECDSA, it's completely different.
But can you encrypt with a public key and decrypt with the private key?
ECDSA cannot be used for encryption. It can be used only for digital signature. And DSA also cannot be used for encryption. It can be used only for digital signature. RSA can be used only for encryption and decryption. And also Diffie-Hellman algorithm helps us to choose to agree on some secret key. But unlike RSA, you cannot know in advance what will be this shared secret key. In case of RSA, Elias chooses secret key and sends it to Bob. In case of Diffie-Hellman, nobody knows in advance what will be the secret key. They do some computations and they get some secret key.
That's right. Diffie-Hellman's what you do use with ECDSA in order to do the equivalent of RSA encryption. Is my understanding?
Diffie-Hellman is not used with ECDSA because ECDSA is digital signature algorithm and not
uses elliptic curve, right?
Elliptical curves, yes. If you allow me, after for the next time I can do presentation for digital signature. I will do.
And it would be nice.
Yes.
All right. Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question.
Yes.
So, are you using any of your knowledge right now in the crypto space? Like, are you using your cryptography knowledge to help projects or working on anything yourself?
At this moment, I'm only teaching, nothing more. Because I came here recently, and that's why. But I like this topic very much. So
obviously. And you did a great job.
Thank you.
All right.
Let's give it up for Michael. Oh.
Thank you.
Do you yourself have cats? Are you an animal lover? Do you have pets?
These cats are my friend's cats. I took permission from them to use them. And the dog also is my friend's dog. And I also got specific permission to use this because I don't want to violate the copyright.
amazing. I love anything that has to do with cats, so I can definitely appreciate it. But yeah, let's give it up for our speakers tonight. They did an amazing job.
Thank you very much.
And we'll be sharing his links and presentation as well as just ways to connect with our speakers in the meetup group. I did want to make a quick announcement before we close. We have one other event up on the calendar. It's actually an event I'm pretty excited for. It's called Privacy and Pottery. For those of you who don't know, I actually have my minor in ceramics, so I've always looked for a way to kind of blend my two worlds, and I'm taking a Zcash meetup as an opportunity to kind of share my passion with you guys. And I'll be teaching everyone just how to make pottery. It's a three-part series. One of the meetups we're going to build, the next we're going to glaze, We're just going to do two meetups. It's a two-part series. But it's going to be on June 28th. So if you come here, I'm going to provide everything, pottery, supplies, food, and drink. Yeah, I'd love to have you here, and I'd love to share that passion with you, Daniel. I'm not going to bring a wheel. We're going to start small with slab building, you know, pinch pots. Maybe one day we'll graduate, but I only have one wheel. So other than that, we are always looking for volunteers at this meetup. You can start tonight by helping us, you know, put your chair over in that pile. But if you know anyone who wants to come speak, if you want to, you know, be a part of collaborating, you can reach out to Chris, Paul, or myself. I do want to shout out our volunteer over here, Andrew. He's amazing, and he's always here. Yeah, that's all. Go ahead and eat, drink, and be merry. Oh, Chris got something.
All right, before we go, I would like to get the speakers to come back up so we can do a selfie. We got a small crowd, but I'd still like to do it. I think it's awesome. Fun. So I'll get Medha and Michael to come back up. And then I think you guys will be good from where you are. Maybe hands up.
We'll see you next time.